Oh yeah, I used to be an absolute trash debater on certain topics. I used to, and that's mainly because I had a very poor understanding of my opponent's position.
So somebody wants to know, what is my take on the non-aggression principle? And the answer is that, taken literally, I think probably nobody believes in it. My favorite counterexample, which was, I think, due to Bill Bradford, who was the editor of Liberty Magazine for a long time. He, unfortunately, is no longer alive, but for a while it was, I think, maybe the best libertarian magazine. And he says, imagine that you somehow fall off of the balcony of your 7th floor, of your 11th floor apartment. Fortunately, the 10th floor apartment below you has a flagpole. You manage to catch on to the flagpole, and you're working your way up to the balcony to get back onto it, when the owner of the apartment comes out and says, that flagpole is my property. I do not give you permission to hold onto it. Do you let go? Anyone want to claim that he or she is willing to let go?
I think when I have a choice between becoming the new paste to the pavement, I'm probably going to just hang on for life.
That means that you don't really believe in the non-aggression principle as libertarians like to state it. I've got a number of other versions of the argument, which you would find in Machinery of Freedom, but I sort of like Bill Bradford's version. And that it seems to me that violating people's rights is a bad thing to do, but there are other bad things in the world. And that if enough is at stake, I would prefer a small violation of your rights to an enormous loss of my life. And that's not really consistent with the way libertarians usually talk, but I think it's consistent with the way libertarians actually
talk. Well, in that situation, you could easily have arbitration over that, have a dispute over that, and in that situation
while
where
you're hanging on?
What, and why should he require you agree it's his flagpole?
Yes.
He grew the tree.
You agree it's his flagpole.
He put the flagpole out on his balcony. So how is there any question that it's his property?
I'm not saying that it isn't his property. I'm just saying in that situation. In that situation, according to the non-aggression principle, the non-aggression principle isn't that nobody will ever, you know, it's that it's unethical to aggress against somebody else, but if someone does, you can have a dispute, and
but if it's unethical to do it, doesn't that mean you shouldn't do it?
Yes, it means you should not do it.
As an ethical position, it is undesirable to commit acts of aggression. How it works practically in a libertarian society is not that nobody would ever commit aggression against another person.
Nobody should commit aggression against another person.
It's that if aggression happens, there is room for dispute, and in the given situation. Specifically for examples like this, there is room for arbitration.
Because in that situation,
I don't think anyone would argue that the person holding on to the flagpole is
doing anything wrong. I will. So if you hold on to my flagpole, I want you to drop.
You heard the lady.
That's something I was actually just about to ask. I don't necessarily know how what you're arguing would go against the Austrian business cycle, because a point which the hardcore Austrians, as you put it, would make, I've never heard anyone argue anything otherwise or claims to be an Austrian economist, is that it is not possible to calculate human action, because it varies in so many different ways that it's not possible to be marginalized to any effective degree. It's not possible to be calculated or observed in an empirical method. well, empiricist, not empirical. You can observe empirical economics. That's not something they deny.
What reason do those Austrians give for believing anything?
Well, it's that economics and market transactions are behavioral actions because they're conducted by individual human actors.
But then what does economics tell you? If all you say is we don't know anything, that's not very useful.
Well, it's not that we don't know anything, it's that it's a behavioral science and not an empiricist methodology itself.
But how do you find out whether your behaviorist theories are true?
I don't know how where's the disagreement here?
Give me a conclusion that you reach from Austrian economics. Are there any conclusions?
Okay, how about the economic calculation problem?
That tells you that it is hard, that it doesn't require Austrian economics. It tells you that it is difficult for a centrally planned economy to run itself well because it neither has the information necessary to do it and so forth. On the other hand, as Ronald Coase pointed out, the economics calculation problem also applies to a firm. Right?
Yeah.
It's a corporation in the market. Yeah.
It's also
faces a problem that it has to coordinate a whole bunch of employees, that it does not have the private information those employees have about their own preferences. Nonetheless, corporations do not seem to act randomly. Corporations, under some circumstances, seem to do a pretty good job of producing things. So that suggests that the calculation problem, although it's indeed a problem, is not as insoluble as the rhetoric suggests.
Well, it's because when you have central planning, you don't have you don't have private speculation, and you don't have supply and demand curves. That's the main difference. No, that is a valid argument.
In the firm, also doesn't have supply and demand curves. The firm has prices.
The labor market has supply.
But the internal economy of the firm, even the internal economy of a family, is being coordinated by a smaller scale version of what a centrally planned government does. If you're curious about this, read Ronald Coase's, I think it's called The Theory of the Firm. It's one of his two famous articles where he's discussing basically making the point that there are indeed problems to coordinating without markets, but there are also costs to coordinating with markets, and that what determines what things a firm does in-house or out-house, as it were, is the balance between those two. That where it is less, that where the deadweight cost of the problems of central coordination is less than the deadweight costs of market dealings, then you do it inside the firm, and when they're greater, you do it outside the firm. Other questions? I think my
on that note,
I'm not disagreeing with you that corporations are a more unsustainable economic model.
I'm not saying they're unsustainable. I'm saying, on the contrary, we've got massive evidence that they're sustainable because they're still there. And they're there not only when they have government advantages, but when they don't have government advantages.
Well, what it is is a legal entity. It's something which exists because it's been legally defined as separate from private enterprise.
And call it a firm instead.
Okay.
Firm, if you like. My argument has nothing to do with whether you have limited liability or not. Firms exist. Firms succeed. If the full-blown version of the argument that's being made were correct, there would be no firm, more than one person in it. And yet
I guess I don't understand what you're saying, because labor markets do have supply and demand curves.
Of course they do. But within the firm, most firms, a lot of employment is long-term employment, where you're not really hiring people by the hour on a spot market all the time. You have basically made a contract with somebody where he agrees that he will come into the office for 40 hours a day and within some wide range do what you tell him to do. And at that point, you are facing the same problem that a Stalinist central planning system is facing, just a much smaller version of that problem.
Well, the problem with the central planning without private speculation or without supply and demand curves is because there is absolutely no basis under which you can reasonably allocate resources. That's why
absolutely no basis has got to be too strong. You can see whether people are hungry. You can see what inputs are needed to produce wheat. That, again, think of any small, not a big project, but small project of a firm of six or eight people or of a family. Think about a family where some of the kids are grown and where instead of having market transactions within the family, you're just all coordinating your activity to produce it.
And in that situation, you have private speculation and you have the ability to, with relative accuracy, distribute your resources according to what would make a profit based on the supply and demand curves. With a centrally planned model of distribution created by the government doesn't, you know, have any...
Supply and demand curves are outside of the firm. Within the firm...
No, I'm not arguing that they're created by the firm.
I'm saying the firm, a firm, when it's buying stuff on the market, it's facing a supply curve. When it's selling stuff on the market, it's facing a demand curve. But it's also making a whole bunch of decisions internal to the firm. It's deciding which worker should do which job, what inputs should be used to produce something. And those are decisions which are not being made on the market. They are being made by some version of hierarchical, centralized calculation, and nonetheless, firms exist that do that. So they're, it can't be that what they're doing is entirely impossible. It may be true that doing a large scale is very, very hard.
Can I just say something real quick?
Sure.
I think I understand what you're saying, David. Basically, that in the Stalin, in Soviet Russia, they had this idea that all economic calculation could be performed with a magical mathematical formula, that if we just had the right inputs and the right information, that we could determine exactly how much things could be distributed without a price system. However, as it turns out, that magical mathematical formula was literally the Sears catalog. But my point is that in an internal firm, whether it's 50,000 people or 5 people, you're still going to have to move resources around within that economy. Say, for example, you need to figure out how many pencils you need to move from the main office to the front desk.
Mm-hmm.
And while there is, of course, a supply and demand for pencils, fundamentally, there's going to be a similar problem in that within that office, there is no supply and demand curve for pencils.
Correct.
Which is, I think, the argument you're trying to...
Making in general is that the kind of coordination that is done by a centrally planned economy cannot be utterly undoable, which is the claim that was being made. It can just be that it's very, very hard, and it gets much harder the bigger the system is you're coordinating. But we know it can't be totally undoable because we observe it being routinely done on a small scale. The Soviet Union had markets too. They could buy stuff from the West. They could sell stuff to the West. From that standpoint, they were just a firm, much, much too big for a firm to be workable inside a world market. That's probably enough. If you're curious, Coase on Theory of the Firm or Oliver Williamson on Markets and Hierarchy give you some idea of the economics of these issues. But going back to Austrian versus Chicago, it seems to me that when Austrians actually use economics to do anything, they have to either make assumptions about facts of the real world or do the same thing the rest of us do, namely see whether or not their theory is true by looking at its implications.
I wanted to actually ask you a question, and this is something, one of the main reasons I was actually excited about being on here, is I wanted to ask you, what do you think about the position of governments being inherently unsustainable due to their inability to actually produce new commodities? They're inherently parasitic entities,
By sustainable. Sustainable is sort of a current catch term. As far as sustainable ought to mean is if you keep doing things this way forever, you can keep doing it.
What I mean is that states, based on their default inherent functions, what they seek out to do, so establish a monopoly on arbitration and collect resources for itself by appropriating privately produced commodities in society. This model is unsustainable for a variety of different reasons, but mainly due to the fact that anything which operates like this has to operate on an exponential growth curve, which means that it's going to end up needing to collect more resources.
How long do I have to show you a state existing for you to be persuaded that you're mistaken? Will 2,000 years do it?
Well, my point is that they always collapse, and they collapse for the exact same reasons.
Well, if you think about the... I was thinking of Imperial China, and it collapses in the sense that there are interregnums between dynasties.
Yeah.
The basic system is set up 200 or 300 BC, yeah, roughly around there, by the Han Dynasty, the first dynasty. And you've got a pretty much a continual progression of that through the Manchu, the last dynasty, which collapses around 1900.
Yeah, you're right. I should probably have been more precise with my language. By collapse, I mean that a current constitution, a current bank, and a current government essentially goes completely bankrupt and is no longer to continue enforcing its laws. So a new one, a new group of financiers take the place of the monopoly and arbitration.
I'm not sure what financiers have to do with it. That is, you can have a government with private banking, as Britain did, and as for that matter, the U.S. did in the 19th century. But we certainly observe governments that existed for very long periods of time, that England had pretty much a continuous government pretty much from the Norman conquest to the present. You've got a little bit of a break with the English Civil War, and you've got some internal conflicts over who's going to run the government and Wars of the Roses and a few other such episodes. But I don't see that governments don't, you know, sometimes manage to exist for very long periods of time.
Well, I'm not saying that they can't, you know, last longer than others. Some of them are able to last for quite a long time. This is because once they start running low on the resources that they're able to accumulate within their own country, they start expanding through conquest.
I think if you look at say England and the US through the 19th century, I believe it is the case that through that century, the percentage of revenue handled by the government was roughly constant. For the US at least, the federal was the smallest of the three branches during most of the 19th century. And was not in fact growing. You get a pattern of government growth eventually in modern history, but I don't think it's, you know, in any sense a uniform pattern. Some governments grow, some governments shrink. I don't see any sort of scientific law, as it were, that says that governments will always grow until they collapse. That's going to depend on the particular that particular government.
I don't know if I'd agree with that. I mean, by the early 19th century, I mean, you had the governments establishing monopolies on the steamboat industry, so not allowing firms to easily enter and compete. So I wouldn't necessarily say that it wasn't expanding, and it was more or less expanding because of the revenue it needed to spend on collecting more revenue from itself due to the expanding industry.
What are the respects in which in either England or the U.S. government was substantially larger at the end of the 19th century than at the beginning of the 19th century?
Well, in the U.S., I mean, essentially the railroad industry was, they had each state had a board of directors established by the government for the railroad industry. It was getting to the point, like, very...
How do you measure the size of government? Government's doing a whole lot of different things at different times. That in some ways, England had a smaller government by 1900 than in 1800 because they'd abolished the corn laws. They'd gone to free trade. In other ways, they probably had a larger. I'm suggesting that a very simple measure is what percentage of the national income was spent by government. And I believe, I'd have to look up numbers to be sure, but I think the answer is that it was about 10% in the U.S. through most of the 19th century. And I think England was similar, though I know less about that. Anyway, it just seems to me this is one of these cases where if you have a theory, you ought to try to test it. And how do you distinguish two different claims?
Well, one, I was asking,
the governments are unsustainable, and the other is that various factors can bring down a government. And each year there's a 1% or a 0.5% chance of something happening that will bring down the government. So if you wait long enough, usually a government will eventually collapse. That doesn't mean they're unsustainable.
Well, you're making, I mean, something that I've noticed throughout this whole stream is you tend to make a lot of assumptions about things that I'm arguing that I wasn't really arguing, but that's essentially just my point. Due to the need that eventually governments are going to need to increase the revenue they collect in order to monitor the increasing industries. And that's because as there's more industry and as there becomes more commodities on the market and as there are more people producing commodities, it needs to spend necessarily more resources in serving these.
Describe it as a growth of government if the percentage of the national income stays constant, but the whole economy is growing.
And that's my point.
Why would that be unsustainable if the government was function collecting 10% $10 billion economy? Why can't it still function collecting 10% of a $10 billion economy?
Real growth is in spending is going to necessarily occur because there's a more expansive industry.
I don't see why it's necessarily. Industries. That's going to depend on a particular government. You're making a general claim. Governments have existed for, 5,000 years or so? And it seems to me you're making a general claim that does not apply to most of those governments in the last 5,000 years. I don't know whether in the various Egyptian dynasties, whether they were increasing production or not, or whether they were getting more varied industries or not.
Well, and that's one way that you are talking about something I'm not referring to. I'm simply talking about the government collecting revenue for itself, and you're bringing banking. Personally, I think banking government.
What you were talking about is collecting revenue in order to regulate industries.
Yeah, it needs to not necessarily regulate industries, but it needs to involve itself in the markets so it can collect more revenue for itself as the markets continue to expand.
I don't see why it needs to. Obviously, people running government would like to collect revenue, but there are various constraints on how much revenue is practical to collect.
It results
in revenue going up, and sometimes it doesn't.
There's more people trading, so there's more taxes which are being collected.
I hate to jump in, but I kind of want to try to wrap things up right now. Fine. If that's okay.
Uh-huh. And yeah, to clarify, I do greatly respect you, Mr. Friedman. It's just, and I kind of, I don't know, for some reason I can't help but
agree with me.
Yeah, you were being asked questions, and I kept making it into debates, and I'm sorry, it's just I mean, if we could have like a formal debate sometime, that would be great.
Maybe.